Thanks for joining us. First United Methodist Church is a welcoming community of faith that strives to be a place where everyone can belong, believe, and become a blessing. At First United Methodist Church, you can come just as you are to grow in your desire to know Christ, as well as discover your own unique way of making the world a better place at 201 Monroe Street in Jefferson City. We hope you enjoy today's message.
Good morning. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Karen Taylor. I'm the pastor of Mission and Discipleship, and it is a joy for me to greet you as well. Whether you're here in the sanctuary this morning, joining us on the live stream, or watching on TV, we are so thankful for the presence of each and every one of you in worship here today. Well, as Pastor Daniel reminded us already, we are beginning a new sermon series today called We Are In This Together, Building Community in Christ. And as we do so, I'm mindful that this weekend is World Communion Sunday weekend. And I'm so thankful to begin this during this time as we are reminded that we are in this together, not just in this congregation, but across the world as brothers and sisters in Christ are sharing at the table today, remembering that we are one in Christ. And so for that, I give thanks to God. So we are looking in this series how that even though we are individuals in our faith, that we are bound together by something that is larger than ourselves. And it is a beautiful thing when we learn that when we come together in our common love for Jesus Christ, that we find we can do more together than we can alone. And so in this series in particular, we're going to be looking at how each and every one of us contribute to this community through our prayers, our service, our gifts, our presence, and our witness. And as we do so, we create this community of togetherness that glorifies God and blesses us and blesses this community. And so today, I'm honored to talk with you about a practice that I'm very passionate about, and that's the practice of prayer. But before we do, would you pray with me? Oh God, we are grateful to be here this day, and open our hearts and teach us to pray. And bless the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts, that they may be acceptable in your sight. For you, O God, are our rock, you are our strength, you are our redeemer. And all God's people said, amen. So for those of us who are members of the United Methodist Church, when we became members of the church, we made a couple of promises. And the first promise goes like this. We are asked, as members of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to Christ? So that's our first loyalty to Jesus Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in our power to strengthen its ministries. And we're asked that question and we say, I will. And so how do we do that? How do we strengthen the ministries of this congregation? Well, we do that through the second commitment or promise that we make. And that second commitment says, as members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? And every one of us said, I will. So prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. These promises are spiritual practices, spiritual disciplines that enable every follower of Jesus Christ, not just members of the church, but every follower of Jesus Christ to grow in their relationship with God and their love and relationship with other believers as well. And so as we think about our commitment to pray for this congregation, which is a part of our membership vows, we may want to begin with a basic question. What is prayer? What is prayer? So prayer is this wonderful gift that God has given us, and it can be as simple as a child's prayer or a cry for help. Prayer can be full of words or can be absent of words. And there are many ways that we can pray, and each way that we pray is a facet of God's prayer for us. But as we bring prayer down to its essence, to its fundamental key part, to the heart of what prayer is, I love this quote by Ruth Haley Barton that says, simply put, prayer is all the ways we communicate and commune with God. It's all the ways we communicate and commune with God, and its fundamental purpose is to deepen our intimacy with God. Isn't that a powerful definition of prayer? It opens up the possibilities of what prayer can be and should be in our lives. And we see that prayer is primarily not something we do, but it's relational. It's something that strengthens our relationship with God. It's how we hear from God, how we learn from God, and it's how we grow in our faith. It's a mysterious gift that enables us to be in conversation with the God of all creation. Isn't that an amazing thing? We are in conversation with the God who created everything, but yet we also know that when we're in the conversation with God, that God is also knows us personally and intimately. And it's such a beautiful and intimate thing that we have this privilege in our lives. But as wonderful of a gift that prayer is for us, we also recognize that prayer can be hard. Prayer can be hard for us. And prayer can be hard because, first of all, we have trouble getting our minds around the fact that we are in conversation with God. After all, we don't typically hear God speak to us with an audible voice. We don't typically see God with our physical eyes. And so that's one of those hurdles for us to get around as we think about prayer. Another reason that prayer can be hard for us is that our lives are so full of distractions. And so for us to have a conversation with God, it requires us to slow down a bit and to pause and to be present to God. And with all the things, the busyness in our lives, the distractions we have, we find that doing that, being present to God, can be hard. Another reason prayer can be hard for us is that we find when we do take the time to slow down and be present to God, we may find that God wants to do some work of transformation in our lives, that God may be pointing something in our lives that we need to get more aligned with God, and we don't want to go there. We can find that a challenge, and we can find that hard because we like things the way they are, and we're not comfortable with God maybe shifting something in our lives. But when we think about prayer in that way and abstain from prayer because of that, we miss the gift that God wants to give us, because we know that God only wants to give us good gifts. Gifts that bless us as individuals and gifts that bless us as a community of faith. And so I would suggest that as we come to a time of prayer with all the challenges and the blessings, that we, regardless of where we are in our faith journey and how seasoned we are in prayer, that we approach prayer as a learner, as a disciple, if you will. And that's exactly how those first disciples approached prayer with Jesus. So will you hear these words from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, verses 1 through 4? Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said, "Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples." Jesus told them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, uphold the holiness of your name. Bring in your kingdom. Give us the bread we need for today. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who has wronged us. And don't lead us into temptation.'" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, I do find it interesting that the disciples asked Jesus this question, "Lord, teach us to pray." I mean, after all, they were good Jewish men, and good Jewish men would know how to pray. They would have been familiar with the rhythms of prayer in their faith community. They would have paused throughout the day to pray to God. They would have prayed in the synagogue. They would have prayed over their meals. Yet there was something about Jesus' prayer life that sparked this question in them, "Lord, teach us to pray." Because you see, as they watched Jesus, they saw that Jesus not only prayed with the rhythms of his community, but Jesus saturated his ministry with prayer. He would pray throughout the night, especially when he had significant decisions to make or there were significant actions in his ministry. Prayer was central to what Jesus did in his ministry. And so there was something about Jesus' prayer life that appealed to them, and they wanted to be like Jesus. And so they asked, "Lord, teach us to pray." And I suggest to us today that that is a beautiful posture for us to take as we consider how we fulfill our commitment to pray for this community of prayer, of faith. To say, "Lord, teach us to pray." And I encourage you to say that right now with me. Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray as a faith community. Teach us how to pray for our faith community. And as we look at this prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, we see that this prayer is for the community. It's a communal prayer to be prayed together and on behalf of the community. So again, let's look at this prayer and notice the pronouns in it. Jesus taught us to pray, give us the bread that we need for today. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who has wronged us. And don't lead us into temptation. Jesus has given us this prayer in community. It's plural. It's not singular. We are in this together. We are in this together. And so when we pray together, when we pray for each other, there is power in that kind of praying, praying for and with each other, because we have the power of the Holy Spirit at work in and through us as we pray together. So members of this congregation have pledged to pray for the ministries of this church, to support the ministries of this church through our prayers. And our first priority then is to pray for the ministries of this congregation. And why is this so important? Well, I think as we look through Scripture, we see that corporate prayer is found throughout Scripture. And so, for example, in Jeremiah 29, 11 through 13, we hear God say, "For I know the plans that I have for you." And this is a plural you. It's a community you. "The plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you, the plural you, a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You, the congregation, the gathered community, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart." This powerful promise is for God's people, not for individuals, but it is a prayer for community. The promise comes as the whole community gathers together and seeks God with their whole heart. There is power in praying as a gathered community of faith because we are in this together. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, the Lord says, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land." And here we hear this promise that God will transform our community as we pray together, as we pray for each other and with each other. Our faith isn't a privatized thing. We are in this together. In Acts chapter 12, we read the story of the Apostle Peter, who was in prison because of preaching Jesus Christ, and his life was threatened. He was facing execution. But God sent an angel to deliver him from the prison cell. And once Peter realized that this wasn't a dream and it was actually happening, he went to the house of John Mark's family. And when he arrived, he found that the believers were gathered together and were praying together. There is power in the gathered community praying together. We are in this together. Sue Nielsen Kibbe shared with our annual conference a couple years ago about what she calls breakthrough prayer and the power of the praying community. And in fact, she also did a session of that here in this church that I had the privilege of attending as well. And she reminds us that there is power in praying together in community. She shared a quote by Oswald Chambers in his book, My Utmost for His Highest. And Chambers says that just as physical food nourishes the physical body, prayer is the food that nourishes the body of Christ. Prayer is the food that nourishes the body of Christ. And so she ponders the question from that quote, if prayer is what nourishes the body of Christ, the church of Jesus Christ, then Are we snacking on prayer, she asked, or are we feasting on prayer? Is it something that we just take a tidbit of, or are we immersing ourselves in prayer? And she goes on to speculate, if we wonder why a church is emaciated and wasting away, maybe, she wonders, we need to ask, are we emaciated because we have been fasting or abstaining from prayer as a community of faith, rather than feasting on prayer together? It's a powerful question to ponder, isn't it? Because friends, we are in this together. So when we are worried about something in the life of our faith community, if we find ourselves unhappy about something, if we tend to complain about something we don't like, maybe instead of doing those things, the place we need to begin is by praying for and with our faith community. Praying that God will open up the doors to new possibilities in our midst. Asking God to breathe new life into the ministries that we are participating in. Asking God to align our hearts and our ministries and all we do with God's purposes in this world, not what we like or what we want. Because friends, we are in this together. Robert Mulholland, in his book, Invitation to a Journey, talks about why this communal prayer is important. He says, prayer is the act by which the people of God become incorporated into the presence of action of God in the church. No, in the world. Incorporated into God's presence and action in the world. Prayer becomes a sacrificial offering of ourselves to God in order to become agents of God's presence and action in the daily events and situations of our lives. It's a powerful statement, isn't it, about the potential of prayer, how prayer incorporates us into God's work in the world, and we become agents of that work. Now, as you hear that and you sit with that for a bit, you may be like me and think, man, that sounds pretty lofty. That sounds a bit overwhelming even, or maybe even impossible. And so if you're sitting in that spot right now, I invite you to say, Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. Because as we come to prayer as a learner, as we ask the Lord to teach us to pray, we find that our prayer life will grow deeper, and we will find that our influence will broaden in the world, and we will find that we are joining God in some pretty significant things in our world. And it begins as we pray together. Lord, teach us to pray, because we are in this together. So how do we begin? How do we do this as a local church, as a local congregation? How do we begin praying together as a community of faith, praying together and for our brothers and sisters in Christ? Well, the way we are inviting you to do that is through a simple prayer practice, and it's a prayer practice that is accessible to anybody, whether you are just dipping your toe in the practice of prayer or you are a seasoned prayer. This is a practice that each and every one of us can participate in. We invite you and encourage you to be a part of this prayer practice. And so what we are inviting you to do is to set an alarm or a reminder for 2:01 p.m. every day. When I set my alarm first, I set it for a.m., and I quickly changed that. But of course, you can pray at 2:01 a.m. as well. But 2:01 p.m., 2:01 for our address, 2:01 Monroe. So set your alarm for 2:01. In fact, if you have your phone, go ahead, pull it out, and set your alarm for 2:01 p.m. or your fitness device. If you don't have any of those with you and can do it right now, would you write it down on a piece of paper so you remind yourself to pray at 2:01 p.m. every day for First United Methodist Church? Will you join us in doing that? And so how are we inviting you to pray at 2:01 p.m. every day? So again, there are lots of ways we can pray. But when that prayer reminder goes off, you may begin by just praying, Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us how to pray for our congregation and for our ministries. You may want to pray for the things that you're concerned or worried about. We invite you to do that. You may want to pray by giving thanks to God for the ministries that are blessing you week in and week out, and asking God to continue to bless the work of that ministry. We invite you to pray for your pastors, for your staff, and for your leaders in this congregation. We covet your prayers, and we welcome those prayers. You may want to pray for our students and children's ministry and the leaders of those. We may want to pray for those who are suffering or in need. Also, we may want to pray for those who need a faith community and how we can be welcoming of those new neighbors that are not with us yet. And if none of that feels comfortable for you right at the moment, it's okay to just sit before God and trust that the Holy Spirit will be praying on your behalf and our behalf. And in that, being open to listening to how God is teaching and forming you in those moments. It's a powerful way that we can be praying together as a community of faith, because we are in this together. And prayer is the building block that builds the community that enables us to do more together than we can on our own. So will you join us as we pray for our faith community in the coming weeks? Would you pray with me? Oh God, we are grateful for the gift of prayer. And once again, we ask that you teach us to pray. In the name of Christ, and all the people said, amen.